Angela Rippon and Mike Stockman present the first in a new series exploring the world of dogs.
Well, this week we've come to the Metropole Hotel, which is in fact right next to the NEC, for the Pedigree Champions Stakes. Now, this is probably the most prestigious dog show in the country. There are only 65 entrants. They're all here by invitation, and everyone is a champion, which means there's every chance that one of the dogs that we see here this week might well end up next week as the Crufts Supreme Champion. Well, someone who knows exactly what it's like to be in that particular spotlight is with me, and it's Ralph Dunn, because it was his wonderful Clumber Spaniel that emerged as the winner last year. Known affectionately as Garfield, but he's got a much better name than that, hasn't he, Ralph?
He has. Show Champion, Rarecraft Socialite.
And what sort of a year has it been for Garfield?
It's been a wonderful year. Far better than one could expect. Incredible.
But you had a lot of people turning up wanting to see this wonderful dog, haven't you?
Yes, lots of people have turned up expecting to see this spotlessly clean, well-behaved dog, and that's not what they found.
What did they find?
A gun dog who was very dirty, stubborn, and did his own thing.
I suppose the muddier and the dirtier, the better for him,
yes.
Really.
Very pleased. He likes that, yes.
He's a very young dog, isn't he? So was it difficult to decide to bring him back to Crufts again this year?
No, it wasn't. It was equally as difficult to decide whether we would continue showing him. And I'm glad we made the decision.
So how do you rate your chances now that you've come back again?
Oh, who knows? The only thing I can hope is that he'll do himself justice in the ring.
Well, I'm sure he'll do that, and that in fact you both will, and we all wish you lots of luck in that, Ralph. Thanks very much indeed.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, as they say in the trade, these dogs here today have done an awful lot of winning, and we're going to take a look at some of the prospects for Crufts a little later in the programme. We're also this week going to be looking at some of the problems that are facing the veterinary profession and indeed dog owners now that the Dangerous Dog Act is in force. And we're also going to be joined by the Blue Peter vet, Bradley Viner, who will have some very useful information for any of you who are prospective dog owners. He'll be telling you the sort of things you should be looking out for before you choose that four-legged member of the family. And once again, I'm delighted that we've been joined by Mike Stockman, who is of course the chairman of Crufts, and he's going to start off by taking a look at the other side of the showing bench.
To me, there's nothing more enjoyable than watching working dogs actually at work and really enjoying themselves, and I had the chance to do just that at the Working Dogs of the Year show at Wembley.
Since dog agility first became a spectator sport in 78, its popularity has grown tremendously. It's now enjoyed by millions at events held throughout the year, at shows and on television. Agility competitions are held in the main arenas each day at Crufts if you want to see some more, and of course we'll be showing the best of those competitions in one of our later programmes. Charlie's just finishing his round in the Little and Large partnership. You may remember him from the TV series Super Dogs. On the day, it's down to the dogs to beat the clock, and you can be very sure the judges won't miss a fault. After that super run from Charlie, it's up to Sherry, this miniature poodle, to bring him in on time. She tackles smaller obstacles than her partner, but to the delight of everyone in the arena, none of them pose a problem. It really is a sport guaranteed to bring a smile to your face. The working partnerships between man and his dogs are many and various. These bloodhounds are part of the Windsor Forest hunt. Bloodhounds' quarry, as everyone knows, is man, or as hunting folk describe it, the clean boot. The quarry ties a rag with his scent to a stick placed upright in the ground, and then makes his escape. 25 minutes later, the hounds are laid on the rag, and the hunt commences usually over a course of some 5 or 6 miles. These friendly chaps don't eat their quarry, of course, though they may well lick him to death. Of course, a dog's keen scenting ability isn't just of use to man for sport. It plays a vital role in the fight against crime, and in particular in finding drugs and explosives. Her Majesty's Customs and Excise now have 61 dogs trained to detect drugs based in 21 locations throughout the United Kingdom. Success depends on a unique relationship between the dog and the customs handler, both in and out of work. And as you'll see, when it comes to finding a suspicious piece of luggage, these dogs have absolutely no difficulty and thoroughly enjoy themselves in the process. They make it look easy, but there again, they were bred to use their noses. There can be few more important man-dog partnerships than that of the sled dog. It's a task that relies on endurance in very adverse conditions. The term huskies applied to sled dogs in general. They're the descendants of three main breeds, the Samoyed, the Alaskan Malamute, and the Siberian Husky. They're capable of pulling up to 300 pounds in weight and can travel over 60 miles in a day. Mushing's now a canine sport with competitions both internationally and nationally. The Sled Dog Sports Federation was formed a year ago to promote the sport. And here we can see the Sibes, captained by Helen Lightfoot, working in what is for them a very unusual environment indeed. They're, of course, used to the harsh conditions of forest tracks and freezing winters. Perhaps the best-known man-dog relationship is to be found in sheepdog trials, and here we can see one woman and her dog, Katie Cropper. She's been entering trials since 1981 and became somewhat of a celebrity when she actually won the television series One Man and His Dog a year ago. Katie puts her success down to the mutual trust she shares with her collie Trim. And here she is approaching the final pen of that historic run in One Man and His Dog. Trim drove the sheep successfully up the field, through into the shedding ring. Maintaining calmness and concentration, the faultless duo penned all the sheep successfully, leaving the judges in no doubt as to who'd won the title. And to prove it's not just sheep that dogs can herd, this is Lad, Katie's three-legged border collie. Lad is every bit as good at herding ducks as sheep. With his gentle but firm approach, and to the delight of the children in the audience, Lad decided to take the ducks for a very unexpected dip. Spurlosh!
Katie told me afterwards that although border collies make marvellous workers in both the field and in obedience and agility, they don't always make the best family pets. And Bradley Viner's been along to talk to somebody whose job it is to sort things out when things go wrong.
Well, Mike, it's great to see such well-behaved dogs, isn't it? Really incredibly well-trained. But there is a danger. There's a danger that somebody who's looking to get a dog is going to see a dog like this and think, unbelievably intelligent, I'd like to have a dog like that, and to rush out and buy one without really thinking about that dog's requirements carefully enough. I'm joined by Julia Dickinson, who actually works for Border Collie Rescue. Julia, how big is the problem in border collies?
Unfortunately, it is rather large, and it's growing every year. We homed just over 600 dogs. That's an actual, that's a minimum amount of dogs last year, 1990. That's not including Scotland and, of course, all the general dog rescues that have collies in.
Like 600, the that's an incredible number. What sort of reasons do they come to you for?
Mainly because they are not the best pet dog to have unless you really understand them and you can really fulfil their exercise needs.
So you're saying that border collies aren't really suitable as family pets?
No, I don't advise them always as family pets. I get a lot of inquiries about border collies, and I generally try and put people off unless they really understand the breed.
Well, Merlin here's been very well behaved, yes, hasn't he? And yet he's a problem dog.
Yes, he is a bit of a problem, and he's a bit of a worry to me at the moment. He's 14 months old, and the people were very careful about choosing him, but have actually given him the wrong environment. They're not at home all day, they're at work. And he's become very bored. He's been left to his own devices in the garden, and now we've got a 14-month-old big and strong dog that's going to be very difficult to retrain and rehome.
Is there a big difference between different strains, different breeds? I mean, for example, between the working dog and, and the show dog?
I think there is. I would never recommend anybody to go to a farm and buy a dog, and I would definitely never recommend to go to a pet shop or a dealer and buy a dog. Go to somewhere where you can see the whole family, not just the mother, but see the mother and the grandmother and the uncle and the aunts. You get a fairly good idea of what type of temperament they're breeding. And if possible, see them in a family environment and not in kennels. And then you know you're onto a good thing.
Well, that sounds like sensible advice. And certainly taking on a new puppy should be a really happy time for all the family. And it is worth taking that little bit of extra time and thinking about it really carefully beforehand, because don't forget, you're going to have a puppy hopefully for 15 or 16 years. So let's go back to basics. Let's join somebody who's thinking about taking on a puppy and consider the sort of questions that they should be asking. I've come to this terraced house in Aldershot to have a word with Aileen Pepper and her daughter Amy, because they're planning on getting a puppy. Hello.
Hello.
Now, before we actually talk about what breed of puppy you get, I think we've really got to go back a step and just make sure that you have made the right decision to get a dog at all. And that's a bit of a downer. You're looking forward to getting a puppy, aren't you, Amy?
Yes.
Have you thought about the basics that you're going to have to provide for this puppy? In particular, have you thought about exercising the puppy?
Yes. We understand that, you know, they need a lot of walking. I'm quite happy about that. And we have the race course, which is quite near, which we can take them for a walk on.
As they get older, they really do need a good run.
Yes.
Two or three times a day. It's good for you, though, as well as for the puppy. And obviously, it's quite a financial commitment as well, right the way through the dog's life. There's the feeding, which is probably the major expenditure, but there's veterinary fees as well, although you can take out insurance against that. You've still got to pay the insurance premiums, and you've got to think about what you're going to do with the dog when you go away. Have you thought about all those things?
Well, I've got someone who can actually look after it for me, and my mum will have it when we go away on holidays. And hopefully we can go on holidays where we can take it with us.
So your grandma's going to help out.
Yes, grandma could help out as well.
Jolly good. Have you had any thoughts about breeds?
Well, I do know someone who's got a Cavalier, King Charles Spaniel, and I quite like the look of those.
They're lovely dogs, aren't they?
Pretty little dogs, yes.
Yeah, I think that's a sensible breed to go for, because unlike many other breeds that we've actually spoken about earlier on in the programme that are involved in hunting and shooting and live very, very active lives, Cavaliers have been bred for hundreds of years now in one form or another, actually as pets, and that's what they're really good at, which is being part of the family and
nice, lively.
Yes, and yet they're still lively dogs that like a good run, and they're not too delicate. And it just so happens that I know just the person to supply you with a super Cavalier King Charles puppy.
Well, thank you.
Now, we've come here today to Sunningdale to meet Joyce Borkman, who keeps five generations of Cavalier King Charles Spaniels here in the luxury to which they so easily seem to become accustomed. What sort of advice would you give to somebody who's taking on a puppy for the first time?
Well, as long as they've got enough time to dedicate to the puppy, they are time-consuming, and you have to know, the training of house training, they're very quick and adaptable Cavaliers. But you must know that when they wake up, you have to pick them up and take them outside. They need five meals a day.
They've had lots of handling, haven't they? Presumably
yes,
that's
important.
Yes, they
have. We have quite a lot of people coming in and out, breeders and friends, and so they do get used to people.
Do you know how to pick up a puppy, Amy? Shall we have a lesson?
Would you like a lesson how to pick up? This is the mummy, so she's getting a bit restless. When you've got a little... When you've got a puppy, you see, you mustn't pick them up and put your hands like that and pull out their shoulders, because it hurts them and it doesn't do them good. So you must pick them up and hold them underneath like that. Support them underneath, and then you've got hold of them, and just keep your feet. That's just right.
Well, Aileen, we've got two lovely bitch puppies here, haven't we? Have you made a decision?
Which puppy do you think Daddy would like? This one.
This one. Okay. She's beautiful, isn't she?
Isn't she lovely?
She is lovely. Well, you've got lots more decisions to make, like a name for one.
Oh, yes.
But,
Rosalie.
Rosalie, yes. I think she definitely looks like a Rosalie to me. Well, you've made the big decisions anyway, and I think you've obviously made them very carefully and sensibly. I brought up my own two children with two dogs, two cats. They've had a wonderful time growing up together with animals. There's so much pleasure that you can get from growing up together as a family with pets. But do take those first decisions carefully, and that way hopefully you'll have a life of happiness together rather than heartache and sorrow.
Well, there's been a lot of publicity surrounding the Dangerous Dog Act since it came into force. There are four types on the act, including the Japanese Tozer and the Pit Bull Terrier. Now, the Japanese Tozer's a fairly distinctive looking dog, but the Pit Bull Terrier, how do you tell the difference between that and a Staffordshire Bull Terrier? Well, in police stations all over the country, there have been large signs pointing out the differences, but Mike Stockman, is it really that straightforward?
No, it isn't. The Staffordshire Bull Terrier, if you've got a purebred one, it probably is fairly distinct. But the Pit Bull Terrier may well be a cross of some sort, and it takes a very knowing eye to distinguish between that and the next breed.
So, Bradley Viner, you sit on the Dangerous Dogs Committee of the BVA. Whose responsibility is it to decide what is a dangerous dog?
It's a matter of persuading the magistrates, really, at the end of the day. I suppose if you believe what the tabloid press say, if you put out your hand and it gets a chunk taken out of it, then you know it's an American Pit Bull Terrier. But that's really not true, because, in fact, I see plenty of American Pit Bulls that are very nice, amenable dogs, and plenty of dogs of other breeds that are perhaps supposed to be more placid that can sometimes be unpredictable. So, really, it's not just down to temperament by any means. And the Act is rather unusual in that, first of all, it describes a type, not a breed, because it's not actually recognised as a breed in this country. And secondly, it's really rather a case of being guilty until proven innocent, because you have to prove that your dog is not an American Pit Bull Terrier.
All right, so if you've managed to prove that your dog is not a Pit Bull Terrier, you may still have a dog that you're slightly worried about taking out in public, and you may well then be accused of having a dangerous dog, though it doesn't necessarily come within the bounds of the Act. What can you do as an owner then?
There is actually a new offence under the Dangerous Dogs Act, which is allowing a dog to be dangerously out of control, and I think a lot of dog owners aren't aware of this, because that applies to any breed of dog. And it makes sense, really, because it means that individual owners are responsible for the actions of their dogs. And if people are at all unsure, then they have to keep their dogs under proper control, keep them on a lead, and possibly keep them muzzled if they have any doubts when they're in public areas.
But you've got to be careful about the sort of muzzle you
use,
haven't you?
Yes, that's right. I've brought along two types. This strap type of muzzle is OK for short-term restraint. If you want to clip a dog's nails and you're actually worried that it might take a peck at you, then fine, pop one of those on. But they're quite dangerous to use for exercising a dog in, because they can't open their mouth. And obviously, dogs cool themselves down by panting, and that's how they regulate their body temperature. And the basket type of muzzle like this is actually much safer, because they can open their mouth, and yet, of course, their jaws are still protected from biting anybody.
We should say that comes in different shapes and sizes to accommodate different muzzle shapes.
That's right, from the Chihuahua to the Great Dane.
Bradley, thanks very much indeed. Timely advice there if you are at all concerned, and get a muzzle for your dog. Well, let's move on to something a bit lighter now. Of course, Crufts really is a show for pedigree dogs, but every year we do see crossbreeds at the various events that we see sometimes in the main arena. And this year, there's to be a whole new breed of crossbreed, one we've never seen before. It's going to be part of the Guide Dogs for the Blind Association demonstration. So we've been down to their training centre at Bolton for a preview of this new dog. The Guide Dogs for the Blind Association celebrated its Diamond Jubilee in 1991. Labradors, Golden Retrievers, German Shepherds, they're all the familiar breeds that you can find in training anytime at the Bolton Centre. Barley and Bramble, though, are two new recruits to the ranks, and they're known affectionately as Labradoodles. As you might have guessed, the result of a misalliance between a blonde standard poodle bitch and a black Labrador dog. Labradoodles were first used as guide dogs in Australia, where they showed great promise. But now it's time for the first two to be trained here in England. But why use Labradoodles rather than the tried and tested breeds? Val Woolrich is Barley's trainer.
The reason we actually decided to try the Labradoodles is because in the reports we had from Australia, the main sort of benefits they'd found was the coat. Although the coat does require attention in clipping, it doesn't molt. It retains, like the poodle, retains the coat. So it was quite useful, or we think it may be useful for people perhaps with asthma or allergies towards animal fur. They both settled in quite well into the centre and appeared very bright. They're very light in comparison to the Labrador. I think probably the two we've got here, Barley and Bramble, have been quick to learn, quicker than the average Labrador. In a lot of ways similar, the temperament's nice, they've got the temperament of the Labrador and I assume the standard poodle, which has got a good temperament, but perhaps not as boisterous as the Labrador. The Labrador just can be rather over-friendly at times. There's still a long way to go. At this stage, we're encouraged with what we're getting. They've shown they've got the ability to learn, and now we're seeing whether they can take on that responsibility in a guiding role.
When the puppies were about 6 weeks old, they went to live with a volunteer family of puppy walkers so they could become thoroughly adjusted to family life, learn basic obedience, and by the end of their stay, hopefully, acquire the three C's: confidence, concentration, and calmness.
Wait, good girl, wait.
Val Woolridge and Barley have been working together for the last 9 months. Barley has had to learn to walk in a straight line, avoid obstacles, and not to turn corners unless told to do so.
Straight.
And as if that wasn't enough, she's had to judge height and width so that the handler doesn't bump her head or shoulders when negotiating obstacles. The trainer's voice and commands are the key to success. Now, this is really all quite advanced training, but the hard work is really just beginning for Barley and Bramble. The next step is to learn to avoid moving obstacles like people and pushchairs. Well, Bramble's clearly a very good pupil and had more than a few distractions to put up with, including a fun fair in the middle of the shopping precinct. But with so much to concentrate on, what other problems face Barley and Bramble in the street?
I think when you walk in towns, people are, you know, they've read about them, they've seen them, and they'll say, oh, look, a Labradoodle, and she's actually picking up on the word now, and he's sort of looking at them, and it's me, yes.
Most of the association guide dogs come from their own breeding programme, which ensures a supply of dogs that have the right physical and temperamental qualities. The question now, are Labradoodles going to become part of that programme?
Yeah, the association has no intentions at this present time of introducing the Labradoodle or the Poodle Cross because, as I say, it's a one-off. We've currently got two. We have another two puppies actually on the scheme, on the puppy walking scheme now. But with anything, particularly in an organisation like ours, where we enjoy a lot of success with the breeds that we've used for years, to introduce a new breed, you would do it softly anyway. I say it's early days, and I'm sure we're all looking with interest to see how these two progress before we take it any further.
Well, I suppose we're used to seeing show dogs being groomed, but really all dogs need regular attention for their general health and well-being. So we've been to a dog parlour in Greenwich to see how it's done by the experts.
Old English sheepdogs are famous for looking appealing on advertising hoardings, but to achieve that special look takes an awful lot of grooming. Billy is 1.5 years old, and she's about to have her monthly grooming session. Well, the first thing is to get her up on the table and establish exactly what she needs. Samantha Hall, an ex-veterinary nurse and owner of the dog parlour, knows just how to make Billy relax.
So basically, you just want her bath tidied up and her nails and her ears cleaned.
Yeah.
Lovely. Okay.
So with shampoo, clippers, brushes, and blow dryer at the ready, Samantha and Caroline set to work.
Because she's been coming since she's been 14 weeks old, she's actually turned out to be a really lovely dog to work with. She's friendly, there's no nasty streaks in her whatsoever. She's a joy to work with because she's always happy. People love seeing her on the table. And basically, she's my favourite, one of my favourite clients.
So, after being clipped and groomed, it's bath time. I think you can tell by the look on her face, she doesn't really like this bit. Still, it won't last too long. And back on the table, Sadie, the Cocker Spaniel, has arrived.
She's being hand-stripped, only for the fact that it is a better finish. Her coat's not too woolly, so you can cope with that. I'm going to hand strip her head, tidy her feet, trim her feathers, she doesn't like them too short, and give her a bath, coat conditioning, and then any finishing off after.
Just pop you under the dryer, madam. Cup of tea, some magazines, perhaps? It's not just dogs' coats that need attention. One of the services that Samantha offers is teeth cleaning. Bad breath in dogs is just as unpleasant as it is in humans, but as dogs get older, their teeth certainly need careful attention. Teddy, the Bichon, visits regularly for a brush and polish. And it's important to scrape Teddy's teeth well and get into all those little nooks and crannies. Sadly, her teeth are decaying, so that extra bit of care and attention is needed. So Billy gets a final once-over, proof that dogs are hard work.
My message to dog owners, if you do love dogs, then you should take care of them and you should groom them regularly and make sure their health's okay, and you shouldn't buy dogs just for the sake of it.
Well, in the ring now, they're judging the special champion stakes. So let's see who's won. And the winner, it's that four-year-old little whippet bitch champion, Nutshell of Nevada. She was runner-up at Crufts 2 years ago. And this is the little lady that's just won that championship. I'm afraid she's actually not going to be at Crufts next week because her owner and handler is going to be one of the judges. But there will be 20,000 other superb dogs there. And our coverage is going to be in two programmes this year. On Saturday, you can join us, I hope, at 6:30 here on BBC Two. And then again on Sunday, we'll be covering live the choice of this year's supreme champion at 7:15. Until then, we're going to leave you with the top 10 dogs from the past 12 months. See if you can pick a winner from all of us here in Birmingham. Goodbye. Approval goes up here at the NEC Supreme Champion, Raycroft socialite,